We'll do something strange. My name is Knut Ulrich, by the way. Some of you might haven't seen the keynote because you are doing something else. Me, myself, is a late sleeper, so I start thinking around 10 o'clock in the morning. Then my head starts spinning, and it spins usually to 2 o'clock in the night. Hopefully most computer programmers, I have this, I worked for Trolltech for many years, and this continued in Nokia. That was, most people came to work around 9 or 10. And we had these core hours, what was for any meeting in this organization should not last for more than 15 minutes, hopefully. Maybe 20, then it was a disaster, basically. And we started, if we're going to have a meeting, it has to be from 11 to 2 o'clock, because then we know people are in. But then we also had this situation where we had developers in Australia, and we had it also in the United States, in 3 time zones. So we also had to be there maybe 8, 9 o'clock in the evening. And it was impossible to get the whole Earth connected without cheating a lot and working 2 o'clock in the evening. And I have this introduction because it leads me to a situation where things have to work in computers which we haven't dealt with before. Most of us haven't cared because computers in general has been focusing the last 20 years on spreadsheet and web, basically. Am I a bit kind of harsh in saying that we have, many of you have probably done more exciting things than spreadsheet and web, but in the big scheme of things, it has been kind of confined to a screen. What you see on the screen is what you get. Agree? So what happens now with Internet of Things is that the screen doesn't count anymore. It doesn't have any meaning. It doesn't really should. The person who uses this technology shouldn't be bothered with looking at the screen at all. They don't care. It shouldn't be spoken to, and we have this debate now in the standardization body in Norway that we have unaware technology which kind of works by you just being present in the room, and then it just works. And you can't see it, you can't touch it, but it do something for you which is to your benefit. Are you with me? It's kind of the force in Star Wars. It feels like that. So something happens which you haven't dealt with before and you don't care, but it's there. And I think Internet of Things in healthcare is like that. The person with dementia does not remember tomorrow to put energy or to charge their phone. They have no clue. They forgot. So you can't give them a device because they will not use it, because they forget. Agree? So how should this technology benefit a person who does not care or just forget? And still they're totally dependent on the service provided and the functions that helps that person to live a decent life. Your grandfather maybe. My grandfather or my mother. So this is the challenge we are in. And this changes everything. It changes user interfaces, it changes how we think. It also might be more simple than we are aware of. And I will kind of bring you into how you are thinking. To get the mechanics thought out on how we can maybe utilize this fact to benefit some new innovations and such. And this is important. The reason we do the source code is because we don't know. People say, oh, I need to go to do something. No, it's because I don't know what I'm going to do. And I might get help from the source code, helping me to do some innovative new stuff. And innovation is many definitions, but one of them is to combine known things, maybe social we already have, devices we already have, into new use cases to the benefit of the user or somebody else that not uses it or uses it indirectly. So now I have taken a kind of very academic background on what we're dealing with here. Okay, we have people who does not know that they are using technology. We have some other people that might know it, but they are totally incompetent and uninterested in technology. And if they're using it, it is a great benefit for those who don't know that they have the benefit, and the persons who don't, absolutely don't want to use that fucking technology. And how does this compute into Internet of Things? And we, was it somebody here that didn't attend the keynote? Raise your hand. You were the only. So I have to take that. That's okay.
Thank you.
You're allowed to be here. That's totally okay. But I need them to do a kind of little rerun of some background so you know what we're talking about. But the short version is that we have now a lot of technology that allows to monitor and control environment around a person, for instance, with dementia. That person might be a person who stumbles or have some heart problems or in the street might just fall. We have people who are falling on the street, which is strange. Most people, you don't fall on the street, do you? Not I either. When I was a kid, I did it a lot. I have still stitches in my knees. But you know, if you might become a little bit defect. My mother said, I'm becoming defective, you know, in steps. First it's my eyes, and then it's my legs, and then they kind of count it up, and they have meetings with other people, and they talk about their defects. And then you are a little bit defected, then you need some help. And one of the things is you can get an open line to a person without calling. So if you have a fall sensor on a phone, it can open your communication to that trusted person that you know. And that person can talk to someone that might be around to give messages or just get aware of that that person is falling and they need some contact to know what it is so they can, for instance, call for help. So such a benefit, this is totally different of usage of the phone. It's very different from what you call, you SMS. It's not like that. You can't touch the phone because you're laying down. Okay? So you need to find a way just to get a notification to that person who helps you, and that person can do something that will help you. You also have, for you three back there, you have the GPS fence, which is what you do for dementia people. They have a GPS tracker with a week of battery. Hopefully we will get devices that can maybe not be recharged more than every 14 days or a month. And when you go away, as dementia people do, beneficially for their health, they will not deteriorate in dementia too fast because they are allowed to go outside instead of being confined to your home. And through that geofence, if people go away, which they do with dementia, then they will not maybe find home again. And in Norway, it's huge. You know, Sweden is huge, but you have huge cities. Norway, we don't have that huge cities, and people go away, and they go away, and you can't find them, which is often happens. And then you have to call the police, the Red Cross, you have to have a huge rescue. And people have died because of hunger, just walking around for 3 days. So this technology, with the GPS sensor, helps that person to be found. And it also gives you a message when it's necessary to do something. So this is kind of technology, sensor technology, controlling things. You have also a situation where you can turn on and off the stove at the kitchen, where they might forget to turn off the stove after going someplace, and the house burns down. Very funny. lot of houses burned down in Norway. We're experts burning down houses because they're made of wood. So you're burning down a lot of things. Just blame the dementia people. That's, we shouldn't be that funny with that, but it's very serious. When people, you know, get into the situation, they forget. The technology suddenly hits in, and it avoids automatically by programming that routine, saying, if that stove is on for more than 1 hour, turn it automatically off. And here it comes. Here's the connection between what it's called unintended effects and the fact that you can do something about it. The key of IoT is very simple. It's two things. It's sensors and it's activators. Those two things is what you have, which you kind of manipulate. Sensors sensor a lot of different things. It can be a video, it can be a fall sensor, accelerator, a lot of things you already have on your phone is already that kind of sensor. So you know those sensors. The other thing is activators. If the sensor gets something, you can also activate some other thing. As I used as an example, turning off the stove. And you combine those things with functions and actions. Small piece of software that decides what you're gonna do. And some person had here the other day in Oslo explained, because it's a huge hobby, IoT, he does a lot of things, he's kind of doing a community on that. And he said, what's making IoT smart is that small piece of software, very small, that you write in and say, if this sensor do something, give you a message, then you should do these three or two things, or maybe five. And then you send that message to control something. So in a way, programming this stuff is super easy. It's like third grade programming in, you know, Scratch. My cat gonna move on the screen 4 steps to the left. So why does this become so immensely challenging? Because it is. And here's the kind of rundown on that. First of all, the people working in this field, having, you know, this expertise on nurturing dementia people and old elderly, or all a lot of other kind of situations. You have a person in Oslo who has been war damaged. He has been in Iraq as a soldier. He's also worked in Sweden as a chef. He's from Great Britain. He's 35 years old, I think. Yeah, he's 35. And he's just worn out. You know, he has been shooting at and working at his chef, you know. He's working 18 hours a day and in very stressful environment. So his body has stopped working. So he falls down on the street, not once a week, but many times a week. And then he can't do anything, he can't move. But he's conscious, he need to be on a strict diet or else he will die. But they have this phone and this sensor technology that gives the message to his friend, I'm falling down on the street, come and get me. And because of this technology and also having message when he's gonna eat, when he's gonna take his pills, and he have a pill dispenser, which we also can connect to the IoT stuff. And then you can message when you take the pills because he has no sense of time. This person, 35, done a great service for his country, and the Swedes getting food. And by that, he can individually live a better life. The problem when he went to say to his doctor, I need this technology to have a decent life and then I can work 50% because I don't need to live on Norwegian welfare, you know, 100%, I want to work. I'm well 3 out of 5 days a week, working days a week. I will work those days because I will work. I'm the guy who works. So he needs sensors, he needs that connected together. But all those devices make him, I call it the pistol guy. He has all kinds of devices, you know, on his body. Nothing is connected together. And the doctor, when he came to his doctor and said, we're going to use this stuff, the doctor said, what? I don't care. You will get 100% public spending on this guy. And he rejected that. So he went to another doctor, a woman doctor, this is important, a woman doctor. And she said, ah, we will try this. We will do this. So they put together a full roundup of this person with all this technology he needed, you know, food planning, the pills he needed, the walkie-talkie effect on the phone, the felt sensors, all those things, and put it together to a package which was a part of his doctor-patient relation. I think that's great. This is how it should be done. And then you put those functions together and you send the messaging if you fall to the right person. That can help you. Or you give the message that you need to take the pill and that in the pill dispensers is ready at the time you need to take it. Because you don't have any notion of time. This package here, this drawing, is we made for explaining old computer geeks in the age of 60 on how you should make this work together. So what it basically says, you have all the sensors here, and you might also have activators running these different features or functions. And then you need to do a function mapping, so we have an understandable, programmable thing that fits into your scripts, which is very simple stuff. Let's call it, instead of action or action templates or function templates, kind of, you can call it. You can call it programmable units, small pieces of software. Very simple. I guess you have the same in the car industry when you are running a car. Yes. And you map those functions over to either something on the screen for that person who helps you, or a feature or a function that runs something on an IoT device. That's the one most single important things in IoT, is that those small functions. Very simple stuff, functioning, putting those functions over to a feature, some programming, and that delivers some actions. It's much simpler than people think. And so if this is so simple, why do we have all these problems with these use cases which these functions represent? Or actions, or those things that you need is help. You need to track someone, you need to put up geofence and such. And I will give you a short roundup of that too. So just mention sensors. We have controls, this pill dispenser. We have alarm central, and we have one down here in this bed. Then you can connect fall sensor, you can connect walking, if people walk out in the dark, which they do at night, you will try. If they wander around, that might be a problem in the night. So you will try to guide them back to the bed. But that happens a lot in an elderly home. And also for people who are peeing in their bed because of incontinentia, that is also a good thing. So do you have services for that? But all those things have different technology, all those different bus technology. Do you use CAN bus in the car industry, or do you have other buses too? CAN bus. Then you have KNX. I have a list here, I'll leave it to you. All the technology we have, and this is a small print because it's so much. Most computer geeks think USB is a git and Bluetooth, and that's it. You know? Done. If you're going to have all those devices, you probably have to support 14 different buses, which is interconnected. And all those are today delivered often in a single mono system, meaning one system from one end to the other. If I have a fault sensor, it will compute directly into an app for that specific use case, nothing else. Nothing is interconnected. But what you really want is to have an individual treatment of each person, because each person has different according to my mother again, defects. Somebody becomes light dementia, somebody falls, somebody has problems with their, you know, down there, somebody walks around in the night, and everyone has their own thing. And by the way, they have, might have combination of things. And not only that, they change it. After a month, they get well from one thing and get another problem. That's all what... You're going to do this talk 30 years, 40 years from now. You will tell your friends the defective bodies competition, I call it. And we need all these things to support some of these features. And we also have people moving in and out of elderly home when they, sorry to say, somebody dies. That's kind of, might be the end station. But some other, they move back home again because they are being operated and they need a, Norwegian it's called konvalesens, meaning that you kind of are living in this house for a month and then you move back to your home because you don't need so much supervision. So we need all these devices here supported. So it's two problems in this use case, big use case scenario. One is that we have all these devices, which is much more than the car industry. And we need those things. So we try to find out how to add those things, or else it just stops and we have 20 things in a pistol belt or 10 different devices with different passwords and all those things. So we might want to integrate them. Or else we can support the individual needs. So what we have done, which has been done for almost 20 years, we have done a lot of function mapping from the devices to a common, call it one view, which have different, of course, use case support inside of that view, but you have one view with all the things connected to a multivariable operation center. Are you following me in this? I'm trying to do it as simple as possible. We kind of lost Standard Norway inside of this. They kind of gave up. But I think what we see here is it has to be multiple. It means we have patient Olav, and we then have Åsa, and we might have Christy. And those are three different persons needing different equipment. And that has to be managed somehow locally for each patient at each institution. But it also has to allow that the parent or the family member can be contacted, some other person that they're related to or have a relation to. So in that scheme of things, we have solved this issue. The challenge is that, and here it comes, you talked about proprietary hardware today, didn't you? The former talk here, and open hardware. Some of these devices and standards are not very open, and others are. And you have to map every device into the system. We have done some of it, or most of it, but it's still not really open. So what we are trying to do here, and this might be in the talk next year, is that we have successfully provided a lot of this integration to the open source community. And we get around this proprietary licensing on several of those protocols. So if you're going to succeed, and here it comes on this scheme, which elderly are used as a use case, which is already deployed in several Norwegian municipalities, is that the whole thing is to try to connect all these things together and provide an individually crafted, personally control over internet of thing services that the person that get the benefit of those things don't know. And through all that, through function mapping, through getting all these devices, is not only possible, they save 200,000 kroner each bed when doing it. Already. And this number was calculated 2 years ago. So I say, which I hope and kind of want you to participate in, is the act of investigating this stuff more, getting more people on board, getting more openness through the different, you know, devices, more than the car industry in Trollhättan, like, isn't that there you are working?
No,
no more cars. They left Trollhättan. Okay. So, but you are doing, where are you doing the research with cars? In here. Okay. Yes. Here. Okay. So we want you to look at this different scenarios, different use cases. This is just one. It's, I can mention 10 of them just on the top of my head, which have similar properties. You need to multivariable control things. I can mention greenhouse, hydroponic. Some of you have maybe already done it. You can do it in surveillance. You can do it in lot of use cases. So my hope is that we next year, maybe just in half a year, are able to come up with a, and show you a roadmap to the open source project of all this technology. I will see, stop there. Thank you for listening. If you have any question, we have maybe 1 minute for that. Yes? It's a, you're allowed to applaud if you want.
Okay, so you talked a lot about services and the protocols and so on the device.
Yes.
And the sensors being connected to the device.
True.
But what about the backend? There's a slew of protocols and functions there also.
Yeah, and I will. The thing, I will give you the protocol map, which is huge, it's humongous, and it's different ISO standard, IEEE standards. It's a standard bonanza, okay? Yeah. So what we did, because this was a huge problem, and it has been for many years. So what we did is to, we know the specification for those standards. And those things are already open enough. It's open APIs, but you can't get the software inside of the device touching it, but it's very simple, something very lightweight ARM stuff. So the API is actually pretty feasible to negotiate.
You might have misunderstood my question. When I said backend, I mean the cloud backend.
Oh,
then for the central.
Okay, the we made the cloud, we made the backend ourselves. So okay, so you
also
have
out of open source components.
Yes. Yeah. So the thing, the reason we use it, of course, as a running system, is that all the libraries is open, all the things are easily integrated. Now we know the APIs on those devices. And this has been made in an architecture, so you can easily plug in new stuff, and it runs because we use standardized ISO defined, you know, for temperature and those things, and it's kind of handled through this. We call it it's a JavaScript engine, very simple. So we can just run dry JavaScripts. I hope that was. Yeah, it's too long. Okay, I see we need to talk in the pause. Okay. Yeah. You know, it might. Yeah, this guy have a question. Just wait for the microphone and he will. Everybody else will hear you.
Yeah. I have a question about the popularity of the Internet of Things, and one of the main concerns of the people who are going to consume those products are the privacy. And especially, for example, I have heard many of the people are not interested to buy smart TVs because the government can
spy
on, and, or even the hackers could, for example, get into your home and control all the devices. Yeah. And even they are extremely dangerous for, I heard, for babies or some smart toys, so they can hear and they can they have a microphone, built-in microphone, and the hackers would easily get access to it and start to.
That is 3-4 things here, and I can't take you the whole trip, okay? The good thing is that we made this stuff, and the only one who get access is the certified person being a nurturer. The doctor, the family member, and they have this fine-grained access control on this system. And you can't get in if you don't do that, to that place. Of course, you can hack into anything anyhow, as long as it on the internet, but then it's a crypto, not a cryptographic, but it is a science project of doing hack, you know.
Cyber.
Yeah, exactly, and that's illegal. And it's also ways of making that very, very difficult, because this company we work with also know a lot of broadband. They deliver broadband equipment for people having ISP and such. I mean, you craft those things so you almost don't get in at all, because you don't want to have the service and support because it costs money. Very motivating. So we don't send anything to Google. It's not Google, it's us, okay? And that device is run by the municipality at the municipality, at the building actually where people are. So it's handled and managed through this web interface. That's one thing. The other one is instituted is the privacy laws, which is regulated pretty hard, and it becomes harder when the EU directive happens in 2018, which everybody talks about. And Norway, as a not an EU member, but a proud user of EU, or else we can't trade with them, we just implement everything with a yes, not without voting. You know, lucky you. Are you from Spain or something? Tell me where you're from. Iraq, okay.
Iran,
sorry. And you got the other guy besides you, you're from?
From Greece.
From Greece. You are in the EU, you have to do anything they say, okay? He's from Iraq, I'm happy. Don't quote me on that, it's kind of more for fun. But we need to follow this regulation privacy, okay? The third thing which we are working on, and I can't talk a lot about, but we are doing it in open research. We think that, and this is just a suggestion, everybody talks about it, so you probably should know it, I'm in open source, so I will just tell it. In Bitcoin, you have
blockchain.
Exactly. And what does blockchain do?
Magic.
Exactly. What kind of magic does blockchain do? Well, it gives you the money, so you know what you have, or if you have the passwords, of course. And it others can't look into your money, can they? No, you have to do a transaction. And thirdly, it's kind of through the network mesh, it taking care of your stuff. So it duplicated, triplicated, whatever. So you can kind of have a security in the network for that you own your own money. But nobody else can really go and look at what you got. Do I get it right? Here. Why do you say you use API as Google? Oh, sorry to be arrogant, but how stupid are you? Yes. Yeah. I can see that. So you kind of get Googleified because they're just there. I can see that. For convenience. Yeah, I agree. So, yeah, we are there and we have also this Google map inside of the application. So you caught us there. So what we need to do, seems that you kind of got us there, we need to use OpenStreetMap. Hurrah!